To Mr. Jake and Mr. Junis. Very good food for thought. Our next speaker is a prominent female politician, well known for her contribution to the effort to reshape marine ecosystems in Europe, while she has served as the European Union Commissioner for Maritime Affairs and Fisheries. Under her leadership, a new fisheries policy was adopted that brought more than 25 fish stocks back to sustainability. She also adopted the Blue Growth Agenda and introduced the system against the illegal fishing for European vessels worldwide. Today, she will be dissecting the importance of ensuring ocean conservation becomes an indispensable partner to development and economic growth. Let's welcome Ms. Maria Damanaki. Maria Damanaki, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hello. I hope you can hear me and see me. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Thank you very much for joining us. I would like to thank you all for attending because I know your time is very valuable and precious, and I'm grateful for you giving some of it, of your precious time. So I would like also to thank the organizers because I'm going to speak to you today about an issue which is at the bottom of my heart, the ocean. The ocean is here, is there for all of us. But for me, coming from a small Mediterranean island, ocean is next to me. It's inside me, I can say. So let's see what is happening with the oceans now and how we can move forward with this ocean business. Let me take the first slide first. I'm sorry, we have some trouble here. Okay, here we are. So I know that most of the people who are attending are coming from the Mediterranean, and in a way they are ocean lovers, but nevertheless, I would like to underline some points about the importance of ocean for our life. First, I would like to say that ocean is very important for the planet itself, for the survival of our planet, because it provides half of the oxygen we breathe, and it absorbs 93% of the world's anthropogenic heat. I don't know if you can really realize how important all this is. To realize it, let's take a breath, a deep breath. Okay, you feel good. If you take a second breath, you feel better. And this second breath is coming from the ocean. Just imagine that ocean will not be able to provide us with this second breath. Humanity will not be able to breathe because ocean is our lung. So this is my first point. We have to keep the ocean healthy because without the ocean, we will not be able to breathe. As simple as that. My second point is that ocean is very important for our economy, our global economy. We cannot imagine modern economy without the ocean. Just to give you an example here, 90% of the world international trade is carried through the sea, 90%. Then the ocean provides us with food. And I'm not referring here only to fish lovers. Yes, fish is a great food and we like to eat it, but I'm referring for 3 billion of people worldwide because they are depending on ocean. Since fish and the fish products and algae and bivalves and all other products of the sea are their first source of protein. So for this, seafood is absolutely important. It's not just an issue of taste or choice. Then I can say that the coastal habitats protect the planet, protect us from floodings and extreme weather conditions. And also they are very important for the biodiversity of the sea and the planet. But also there are a great source of income for billions of people worldwide. Let's take the corals, for example. Coral reefs alone contribute 11.5 billion to the global tourism each year. Just imagine the coral reefs and their value. And then I can say also that the full potential of the ocean is not known yet. There are hidden treasures there coming from the bottom of the sea in a lot of different types. And just an example here is the fact that me personally, but everybody else around me, we were very, very surprised at the beginning of this pandemic, COVID, when we realized that all the trials for medicines and vaccines have been based on a genome coming from the deep, deep sea, the deepest sea. So we don't know what are the medicines coming there. We don't know what are the bioeconomy potential there. And that's why there is a big international discussion now about the rights of the governments and people who use these genes. This is a very interesting discussion for our next meeting. My last point, the ocean is our last frontier. It's our last wonder. It's our connection to the natural world. The ocean gives us not only food, energy, leisure, it gives us dreams. We can dream about the ocean. It's far away, it's an adventure. And dreams can keep people happy. And why are we doing this? We're doing all this to be happy. So personal happiness is very, very important. So this is why ocean is important. And the ocean will be here for us in the future, and its potential is enormous. But we have to have in mind that ocean is important. I'm not going to refer to this slide a lot. I think that we are all well terrified by the first presentation and all the images we have seen. And I don't want to terrify you more, but just to refer to some facts. So climate change and the greenhouse emissions, they make the ocean warmer and more acidic. And they have another effect that is not very well known, and this effect has a name, sea level rise. So perhaps you can think now, okay, 1 or 2 centimeters, does it make sense? Well, it makes sense. It makes sense because there are studies in the United Nations that prove that if we're going like this, at the end of the century, 630 million people will have the risk of living in their area. So perhaps they have to leave their houses, their villages, and reallocate themselves. And I can say to you, by my personal experience, because I have worked throughout a similar program in the Pacific, that this is really appalling. Thousands of people losing their homes, their villages, it's really terrifying. Terrifying. So we have to do something about the ocean. Also, I can refer to the loss of biodiversity. The ocean has lost 50% of its biodiversity in the recent 50 years. So perhaps some important species have already disappeared. Some corals, the most beautiful ones, fish has disappeared. And on the other side, there are species that are more tolerant to the climate change, and they have the populations, their populations have really increased. Microbes or jellyfish. So next time you will see a lot of jellyfish in the Mediterranean, you know who to put the blame on. Then I can refer to the pollution. Plastic is well known, but it's not only about the plastic. We have to have in mind that almost 80 to 90% of the waste which is coming to ocean is coming from the land, and it's not only plastic. We have nuclear waste going there. We have toxic and very, very dangerous waste going there, and we cannot say that we are fully informed about what's happening when all these materials are going to the ocean. So stopping pollution in the ocean is important. And then I can refer to overfishing. We can discuss about that later if there is time, if you want. Less and less fish in our seas, in the Mediterranean especially. But what I can say to you is that we have a proof from FAO, the United Nations Organization in Rome, that 1/3 of the fish stocks worldwide are fished at a level which is not sustainable. So this is worrying. So I suppose that after all this, the potential of the ocean, the threats for the ocean, there are two questions emerging. The first question is, can the ocean survive? Can we keep the ocean happy if we are going to continue to extract from it, take the resources that we need, and the humanity needs the resources? It's not so easy to say stop fishing, stop extracting. It's not so easy to say that, because you have to have in mind local communities and really poor local communities in some areas, not like here. So can the ocean survive? Can we keep both ocean and humanity happy? And the second, of course, question is, if we can, how we are going to do that? So these are the two main questions I would like to answer through this short presentation, to give you some answers, of course. My answers are coming, of course, from my personal experience, but I would like to underline that most of these slides, we have prepared them for two organizations, big organizations I'm working now, and they have done a great job on that. The first organization is a big think tank in London called Systemic, and the second organization is the High Level Panel for Oceans. I'm chairing their network. So this High Level Panel is created by 14 prime ministers, so very important countries around the world that represent 30% of the ocean of the planet. I'm talking about big governments, big countries like Canada, Australia, Japan, Indonesia, Norway, Portugal from the European Union, Ghana, Kenya, Namibia, Chile. So the 14 prime ministers, they are committed to go for sustainability, to invest their blue economy sustainability in a sustainable way. And they have also committed to have a good marine special plan for their exclusive economic zones. I would like very much to see Greece joining this club, but to be honest, I cannot see a lot of appetite now. So let me go back to facts. It's better to work on facts. This is my experience and advice to the younger people. So here you can see five building blocks we have created in the framework of these organizations, working with United Nations and the special envoy of Gutierrez, Peter Thompson, Ambassador Peter Thompson. These are the building blocks to go for a sustainable ocean economy. Let me go through it very, very fast. First block is the science, the data. We need science. And I think this is a very, very good lesson learned by the pandemic. When science was ignored, it was not so good. Just remember Trump and the USA administration. So we need data to drive our decisions, and we have to use the innovation tool networks to have the data. Second block, we need to engage in a good orientated planning process. We need a plan. Some people, and especially some investors, they think that the ocean is out there, is there for all of us. And if the ocean is there for all of us, then as you can perhaps think and understand, well, we can do everything and the Mother Nature can restore it. This is not true. This is not true. The ocean is there, but we need some plan. We need a governmental plan, we need a regional plan, we need a European plan, we need a global plan. So this is really very, very important. This is really very, very important. And I'm very proud to say this because, as you know, perhaps the first planning directive for the European Union is a directive that has my signature, so it will be very, very important to go through this planning exercise for all of us. The third block is de-risking finance and using innovation to mobilize investment. We need money, in other words. And money is not just a detail. In my opinion, the private public partnership is the best way forward. But what I would like to say here is that banks can play a very, very crucial role in developing all these pipelines. I can share my personal experience. I was working 3 years with the government of Seychelles for a debt swap. They would like to exchange their debt for conservation measures. and everything seemed impossible. But then World Bank came in and they gave their guarantee for the fund we had created, and everything was easier. So the banks can play an important role, and I hope they will take the message. Then, of course, we have to stop land-based pollution. And then, this is the last point, and it's the most important. We have to change ocean accounting. We have to give ocean a value. I would dare to say we have to give ocean a price. And why I'm saying that? Because this is the tragedy of common goods. Natural capital, the ocean capital, is used by the investors for free. But this is not for free. The ocean belongs to all of us. It doesn't belong to a fisherman or to an investor who extracts from the bottom of the sea or whatever. So it's important to give ocean a value. We are working now to create models with United Nations, and I hope that in the assembly next September, we are going to present some. So if we are going like this, here is the good news. I would like to give you some good news, because I'm afraid we have received a lot of negative messages. So here are good news. We can have a triple win. And what do I mean by triple win? I mean a win for society, for economy, and for environment, and all together. And this is a very important slide. You can see my resources at the end of the footnote, and it's through models that are scientifically checked. So you can see that we have a protecting pillar, and through this pillar, we are going for 30% protected marine areas until 2030. This is the famous 30 by 30 goal. Perhaps you have heard of that, to protect 30% of the ocean by 2030. If we can do that, we are going to give 20% of the Paris Agreement there. We can reduce down to one fifth the greenhouse emissions. Can you imagine that? 20% of the Paris Agreement is coming through this plan. Then we can produce sustainable, and I can say here that we can have 40 times more renewable energy by 2050, or 6 times more sustainable fisheries, because we can explain why if you are interested. And most important, we can have a prosperity that can be shared in a more equitable way, because we are going to create 20 million jobs. And we are going to earn profits of 15.5 trillion. A lot of it can go to SMEs. I'm coming to the previous presentation. Okay. So here is my next slide. Perhaps you are wondering where are these trillions. I don't want to bother you with a lot of numbers, but the evidence is here. So we have this model. Has a prerequisite. We invest 2.8 trillion today in 4 sustainable based solutions. We can see mangroves, international shipping decarbonization, ocean based production, and offshore wind. And we can end up to 15.5 trillion. Ocean can be a solution to climate change. If you are interested, here are the figures. I don't want to take a lot of your time, but you can see here, for example, that if we are going to invest in offshore wind, then we can have 3.5 gigatons of CO2 emissions absorbed by this case, gathered rather by this case. Or if we have, if we will be able to absorb carbon from the seabed, then we can have 2 additional gigatons. All these are gathering into the 20% of the climate change solution I have said before. Here is another model. I'm giving you all these examples just to reassure you that there is a lot of work. Modeling and scientific work, and all of these I'm saying are facts. I'm not saying something based on my wishes or ideas. These are facts. So we have created this model for the United Nations, and this is the model for the countries that would like to focus on the sectors of the economy that can be more profitable after COVID. There is a lot of economic and financial analysis behind that. but we can see what are the areas, for example, waste treatment or coastal and marine ecosystems or mariculture, ocean-based, renewable energy, or marine transport. But referring to aquaculture, to mariculture, I would like to clarify because it's a very interesting point for Greece too. I'm referring here not only to snapper, grouper, and salmon, not only to finfish. I'm referring to the restorative aquaculture too. So it is proven that seaweed aquaculture and bivalves aquaculture, they help the environment. They don't put a burden to the environment as the other kind, perhaps, of aquaculture, if not sustainable. They absorb nutrients, so they clear the water. And that's why we have to invest on that. And I'm very happy that my successor in the commission, Commissioner Symbiosis, is going to take a big initiative on algae for the next year in European Union. So here is a model for circular economy. I know that this is at the heart of this conference. And this is a model I'm very proud of. We have worked that, with that in systemic. And why I'm proud, because it can give you also an analysis of what will happen with business as usual. And this is something, this scenario of no action is something that we have always to have in mind. It's not only about the good things that are coming. We have also to have in mind what is happening if we take no action, if we are just sitting and waiting. And in this case, we are going to put almost 30 million metric tons plastic in the sea until 2040. And there will be a damage in the United States in dollars, 100 billion in different businesses. On the other side, if we are going to do it right and for saving time, I'm not referring to how, but there is a how we're going to do it right, and we can reduce 80% of the plastic from the ocean. Here I give you some economic zone, sustainable ocean economic zone examples I'm working on. Why I'm putting this slide here, just to persuade you that there is no one size fits all model. We don't have a solution that goes everywhere and can be there and match everything. This is not true. So here I'm working with different governments. These are some examples we are presenting. So the first example is more on tourism and local food. The second example is more on artisanal fisheries and tourism. The third example is more on an industrialized perspective of the economy, but they have common management elements and they are referring to the principles I said before. So here is a slide that can prove that if we keep the ocean and humanity, as I said, healthy and good, then there will be a distribution to all the 17 targets, sustainability targets of United Nations. This is a study we have prepared for United Nations and it was presented in the assembly last year. So here you can see that ocean can contribute to areas you cannot imagine. For example, at the bottom, you can see the sustainability target 16, which is about peace. Can the ocean sustainability contribute to peace? Yes, it can. And I have lived that in person working in China. And perhaps you have heard about the South China Sea disputes with Japan, with other countries, in Philippines, between Philippines and other. So if we are not going to solve it in a proper way, this will damage us all, not to refer to the GLC for obvious reasons, especially today. But also there are other areas where it is very, very important and good to see. So let me finalize with my final message. Here is what I would like you to understand. The ocean is not too big to fail. The ocean may fail, may fail. The ocean is big, too big for us, for our senses, for our minds, but it's not too big to fail. And if we are going to do it wrongly, as we have done in the land case, then perhaps we'll see the same story. And the first presentation we have followed today will be the truth. The second point is the ocean is not too big to fix. We can fix it in a decade. If we want to use the next decade to fix the ocean, we can do. We can do. Yes, we can. But we have to invest, and we have to invest properly. And what is going to be invested in a sustainable way is going to pay us back more and more, sometimes five, sometimes six times more. So it is worth trying. But to make a long story short, is too big and too central for the planet's future to ignore. So my hope is after this presentation, we will not go on and on ignoring ocean. This is what I would like to say. Thank you very much for attending.
Thank you very much, Ms. Damanaki. Before we move on to the next session, just a quick question for you. No doubt you're one of the most symbolic women in Europe. We see that the younger generation is increasingly aware and active in the existential fight against the climate crisis. What would you say to young women and men that who want to make their own creative and meaningful revolution to protect our common home, but many times they feel that they lack the power and means to do so?
Thank you very much for these kind words. But as you mentioned, I'm rather too old to give advice to young people. So what I would like to say is that we, my generation, cannot advise. What the young people can accept is advice from young people. And I can tell you a personal example about that. I was attending last year, before COVID, of course, National Assembly, the General Assembly of United Nations in New York, and we have given so many fights with governments, whatever. And then we went out and Greta Thunberg was speaking. And there were millions, 2 million, if I remember well, of young people following her. So we need guidance from younger people. And this means that younger people can be, how can I say, motivated if they think that the message is coming outside of the system. Unfortunately, I'm perceived by them as a member of the system, rightly or wrongly. So they don't need advice from the system. They need advice from outside the system. And my second point is that the technology is the way to approach them. The new ideas, the innovative tools of technology, they can give us a chance. And I would like also to add that there is not a coincidence that in other areas, in other countries, in other areas of the world where the technology is much more advanced and more spread between young people, there is a motivation about climate change, the oceans, the sustainability, these issues. Here we are lagging a little behind, but I hope we are going to do the extra mile. Thank you very much. You were very flattering, but you need somebody like you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Damanaki.